short.
Yeah.
Check, 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 1, 2. Check, testing, 1, 2, 3, 4. Hey, hey, check, 1, 2.
One, two, three, oh, finally. What's that? Good to see. Box, one.
Coming back and forth.
One, two, six, seven. And one, two, three. Y'all having as much fun as I am up here? Okay, just checking. Oh, hey, I think we got it here. I don't know what you just did, but that remember it next time because it worked. Well, good evening and welcome on this wonderful Saturday night. Y'all warm enough? Okay, just want to make sure. Don't want anybody to get chilly before the end of the night here. Well, you all look absolutely...
Check, check. Check, 1, 2, 1, 2. Check, 1, 2, 3, 4. Hey, hey. Check, 1, 2. Testing, 1, 2, 3, 4. Hey, hey. Check, 1, 2. 1, 2, 3, 4.
5, 6, 7, 8. Well, so far so good. Once again, ladies and gentlemen, delighted to welcome you all to our Hall of Fame Induction Banquet Program. National Multicultural Western Heritage Museum. How many people have never been here before? Raise your hand. Oh, my gosh. Well, look at that. We've got quite a few folks. Well, this is something that the lovely Austins put together. Is it 18 years now? Is that right, Jim? Do you all know Jim and Gloria Austin? Please stand up and take a bow before we proceed here. And before the end of the night, they'll both be up here at the podium and sharing all kinds of incredible information with you all. But I'm sure they'd like to, at this point, thank you all for being a part of what has become a very, very, very special night here in the great city of Fort Worth, Texas. So whether you're from this great state of Texas, or for that matter, you might have traveled from someplace else, we are delighted to welcome each and every one of you. My name is Scott Murray, and I'm going to be serving as your man. How many years have I done this? Late 50s, I think we started, didn't we? Wasn't the late 50s, a long time ago. But at any rate, for those of you that might not be aware of it, I was a sports anchor on the NBC affiliate here in town for 25, 30 years. Retired a few years ago to go into business with my son. We have a television production company. But the bottom line is, I do a lot of charity work like these things. And Jim and Gloria became friends decades ago. Good people with a great commitment to make a difference in the life of those that need it most, and honor those who have made a difference. And that's exactly what we're doing here tonight. So I'm most honored to be a part of this incredible evening, and certainly hope that by the end of the night you'll find it most meaningful and a well worthwhile spent Saturday night to join us here in the great city of Fort Worth. We've got lots to share with you during the course of the night. One thing that I want to tell you that I just found out about 5 minutes ago, if you have friends that say, oh gee, I'd like to have gone to that hotel in Fort Worth with you and watched the program tonight. Guess what? I just found out that we are going to be on YouTube tonight. That's right. So you can link to YouTube. Yeah, how about that? We are streaming live. So now how do I do? Were we going to put something up on the screen? Or
we didn't want to mess up the presentation.
Okay.
So just go to the national. Go to cowboysofcolor.org.
Cowboysofcolor.org. O-R-G.
Yeah.
Cowboysofcolor.org. And there should be some information there that you can share with your friends and tell them that how they can come up and be a part of this incredible evening. So we're live right now, right?
Live.
We are making it happen right now. So that's great news. So thank you, thank you, thank you. Streaming live as we move forward. Now, the first thing I'm going to do is say thank you for being here, and the second thing I'm going to do is, where are they? Here they are, right here. We have the Scout Troop, Scoutmaster Tony Lampkin, good friend, and he's always been involved with us and very, very supportive. Boy Scout Troop 528, chartered by Shiloh Missionary Baptist Church here in Fort Worth. So I'm going to ask that you all please stand for the presentation of our colors, and that'll be followed by our Pledge of Allegiance. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me with the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Color guard, retired. Thank you both very much, gentlemen. Please be seated, ladies and gentlemen. At this time, I'd like to call forward Harold Cash, who, by the way, is a former inductee. He's a member of the Hall of Fame back in 2010. So Harold's going to come up here and share with us our invocation this evening. Harold, good to see you again.
Good evening. Want all heads bowed and all eyes closed for the mighty, mighty God we serve. Lord, I'd like to thank you for last night lying down. I'd like to thank you for looking over all of us while we sleep. And I'd like to thank you for waking up this morning, Lord. A lot of people thought it was the alarm clock and the rooster, but it was touching your hand, Lord. We'd like to first, take care and bless the families that lost the 19 and 2 in Uvalde. I'd like to thank our servicemen that's keeping America what it is today. And a special thanks to Jim and Gloria Austin for having a dream to represent the National Multicultural Hall of Fame. It is the historical for the Black Cowboys. The Black Cowboys was the forgotten man of the West. We'd like to thank all the inductees that's getting inducted tonight, Lord. And just take this and do just what you want to do with it, Lord. Lord, we know we asked for a whole lot. We'd like to, you made a blind man see. Lord, you raised the dead. And now we're living in a microwave society. If we don't do it right now, you don't do it, we won't believe it. So all the things that I asked for, if you don't do none of it, you did enough when you gave your darling son, Jesus Christ, for our sins. Lord, but we would want you to bless the food that we're about to partake tonight. We'd like to bless the cooks that prepared it and give us traveling grace back home. Lord, we ask all these blessings in your name. Let us all say amen.
Amen.
Thanks, Harold, very, very much. We very much appreciate it. It's great to see you again. Well, ladies and gentlemen, we've come to that time of the evening. It is time to break bread and enjoy the fellowship at your respective tables. I do want to remind you about one thing. Please enjoy your meal and in the fellowship, as I mentioned, but we've got an incredible silent auction over here at this end of the room. So maybe during dinner, if the conversation gets not to your liking or whatever, and you want to make some hustle down there and make some money for us all on behalf of the museum, please do so, because we're going to keep that open during the better part of the program. But that would be a good time to do it. So I'll leave you alone. Thank you again to you all for being here. Enjoy your dinner. Enjoy the fellowship. And we'll be back with our official program very shortly. Thanks so much, everybody. Well, ladies and gentlemen, we hope you're enjoying your salads and your dinner and dessert to follow, but I have just been made aware of the fact, and I had no idea they were going to be here live. I thought this was going to be some taped music, but they are live and in person. They are in the house, as they say. I'm talking about Al and Essie Morris, and they are, have you ever heard them before? Anybody?
Yes.
Well, you're in for a treat. Let me simply say that. So, Al, I'm going to turn it over to you. Take it away, my friend. You and Essie, just knock your socks off and take it home, as they say. Great to have you here.
A very special hello. You kept going for a can and check it. It's not your furniture. We call the salad. That's the proper way to eat it. And I told my daughter, don't you touch mine. It is a delight indeed for Al and Essie to be here. And everybody under the sound of my voice,
well,
no matter who does what the rest of this evening, let us all remember James and his glorious, I call her ugly, she's so attractive, I call her Miss Ugly, awesome. They deserve it, and I am so proud and thankful to God in heaven to be standing here. Now, no booing. Al and I don't play taste. We're up here just by ourselves. And the whole idea is to share something. And the Academy of Country Music has started calling us Mr. and Mrs. Country Soul in 1984. We were doing a show out in Long Beach, California. And since that time, we dropped the name Texas Cotton Pickers Association. And we started, when did I pick cotton? I didn't pick much, but I picked a little. And my mother caught me putting rocks in it, and I got a ribbon for them. That's not disgusting. People, it's a pleasure. And I mean it from my heart for us to be here. We hope that somebody enjoys a little something.
Amen.
1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3.
Keyboards are not on. Guitar not on. Is the sound man in the house? Sound man? No. No guitar. I can get in the sound of the guitar.
Is the sound man here?
Sabotage. SABERCODGE. I
Thank you. 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. Right.
Something, hello, mic check.
Something. Testing, 1, 2, 3. Testing, testing, testing. 1, 2, 3. Mic check, 1, 2. That was not very good, but we're going to keep on going. This adds to the digestive process. Just keep chewing. Keep on chewing. You'll be all right. People, we're having a little trouble here with the tech. We're going to have to leave it alone, I think. We don't want to spoil everything. Let's leave it alone. We're going to leave it alone. Because it's time for him to start.
We're having problems with the drum machine. Not playing right.
We're gonna do one more, try to do one more, and then we're gonna stop. Something is wrong, but we're gonna say one thing. Apology, we don't have a thing, but our instruments and something doesn't sound right.
We can't.
Please accept an apology. We can't. Something's not right. Yeah. No, I'm not getting anything. Don't let us spoil it.
No, we can do this.
Something's wrong.
Something is wrong, folks. We're offering an apology because we're not going to spoil this program. It's too nice.
Thank you.
James, thank you. Everybody, we all.
what a mess that was. Oh, what's going on? You know what? You know what? Yes, move in.
No.
No, what's that? Thank you.
Hello, hello, hello.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, in the interest of time, we're going to go ahead and move on with our program. Please continue to enjoy your meal, but we have two live auction items that really are above and beyond, and we're really excited to have these two live auction items. So we're going to get our good friend Chuck Darling up here, our auctioneer extraordinaire, and he's going to try and make as much money as we can, and somebody's going to walk away with a couple of great items, or a couple of people will, huh? All right, Chuck, take it away, my friend.
All right, good evening, everybody. My name is Chuck Darling. I am your auctioneer this evening, and I want to say thank you all so much for being here tonight. And I know we could not do this without Jim and Gloria and all the hard work that they do, but also at the same time, we couldn't do it without you all being here tonight. So we actually have two live auction items tonight that I want to talk to y'all about. So I want to make sure everybody totally understands. If you've ever been to a live auction, you know what the objective is here, is to raise money. Now, as an auctioneer, there are a couple of things that I look for as an auctioneer. There are, number one, you raising your hand, that's considered a bid. If you take your hat off, that's considered a bid. If you're talking to the person next to you, that's considered a bid. If you get up and go to the bathroom, that's considered a bid. And I can talk fast, so be quick. All right, so we want to make sure that we get this going. We've got two great items, and here's the very first item, and I want everybody to make sure that they do get an opportunity to do this. This is going to be for a cozy three-bedroom log cabin in the mountains, which we would all like to be at right now, in Cripple Creek, Colorado. Let me tell you a little bit about this. This is a cozy log cabin, has three bedrooms, two bathrooms, great space for away and for home, but still, if you have to work, you can do it from here. Cozy up to a wood stove fireplace. It has a view that will take your breath away. The cabin has it all. Covered deck, wildlife, and seats outside on the log swing with a glass of wine and watch the sunset. You also have a secluded mountaintop, which is the best time to be in Aspen in that area, is in September to October. Is the time of the year, because that's when they start to change colors. It has a full kitchen. All you need is the food. There's TV for movies and games, but also you have the opportunity for fly fishing, hiking, and Cripple Creek Casino, for those of you who like that, is only 6 miles away. You're gonna say, well, if I go there, where do I fly in at? Well, I'm going to tell you where you're going to want to fly into here is Colorado Springs Airport. You have 1 year to be able to use this package from today's date. So three bedrooms, two bath. This is a great opportunity. Get out of the heat. But if you want to get a chance to get out, if you've got a birthday, anniversary, I'm in the doghouse and I need to get away, this is your package. So here we go, let's start this off. Let's make this real easy for everybody to go. Somebody show me $500 to do this. Let's go, $500 a bid. Somebody give me $500 a bid, now five, now $500 a bid, now five. Now we give me $500 a bid, now five, now 500. And I give me $500 a bid, now five. Oh, y'all gonna make me work here. All right, I'm gonna make this easy for everybody. All you gotta provide is airfare or drive up there. Let's do it for $100. Who'll give me 100? I'm gonna go for $100. Who give me for $100 a bid? I got $100 a bid, now two. Now 200 a bid, now three. Give me $300 a bid, now three, now three. I'm in for three. 300 a bid, now four. Now 400 a bid, now four. Now 400. I need 400 a bid, now four. 400 a bid, now five. Now 500 a bid. Somebody give me 500. I got 500 a bid, now six. Now 600 a bid, now six. 600. I need 600 a bid, now six. Somebody give me 600 a bid, now six. 600 a bid, now six. Now 600. I got 600 a bid, now seven. Now 700 a bid, now seven. Now, sir, back to you, sir. That's 700, sir. 700. Let's go 700. 700 a bid, now eight. We give me 800 a bid, now eight. I got 800 a bid, now eight. We give me 800. I need 800 a bid, now eight. I got 800 a bid, now nine. 900, sir. We give me 900. 900 a bid. Now nine. Will you give me 900, sir? Now 900 a bid, now nine. If she gives you permission, sir, will you go 900? That's what we're doing. She's pointing. You can pay. That's right. You got three bedrooms and two baths, sir. 900. 900. He's looking at her. She's looking at him. 900. I need 900. Go ahead and my 900. Will you give me 900 a bid? 900. 900 a bid, now 1,000. I need to give me $1,000 a bid, now I need one. $1,000 a bid, now one. I need $1,000 a bid, now one. I got 900 a bid, now 1,000. 900 bid not gone once. This is a steal at 900. 900 bid not twice. All through, all done. So 900, your direction, sir. You got it right through there. You're going for 900. All right, here's the last item up for live auction, ladies and gentlemen. So if you did not get a chance to bid, this is all you're gonna do. Let me ask you this question real quick. Do I have any Cowboy fans in the house? Like, oh, there we go. Let me hear you make some noise if you're a Cowboy fan. There you go, that's what I'm looking for right through there. Here we go, here's what you're looking at. This is gonna be for four tickets to see the Dallas Cowboys and the Seattle Seahawks on August the 26th. You're gonna be in section 144, row 18. So which that means is you're gonna be in Jim Austin's personal section is where you're gonna be sitting right through there. So this is an opportunity for you and three other guests to be able to go see the Dallas Cowboys play the Seattle Seahawks, which no longer have Russell Wilson. Sorry. All right, so we're gonna go for this. Who wants to go see the Dallas Cowboys August the 26th, which is a Friday night game? Let's go see the Dallas Cowboys. Somebody show me $100. Who give me $100 to go for four tickets? I'm gonna be in for $100. I got $100 to bid now, two. I got $200 to bid now, three. I'm in at $300 to bid now, three, now $400. I need $400 to bid now, four. I got $300 to bid now, four. $400 to bid now, four. I need $400. $300 to bid now, four. I need $400 to bid now, four. I got $300 to bid now, four. Where are my Cowboy fans? I'm at $300. $300. $300 to bid now, four. I got $300. I got $400 to bid now, five. Now $500. Will you give me $500 to bid? I need $500 to bid now, five. Will you give me $500? I'm $500 to bid now, five. Ladies and gentlemen, the value of this package is over $700. I'm looking for $500. I got $400 now, five. Will you give me $500? Somebody give me $500. There's four seats. Yes, ma'am, you got it at $500 right through there. $500, that's four seats. You're probably gonna be sitting with Jim Austin himself down there. That's four seats right through there. I got $500 now, six. Who give me $600? Give me $600 a bid. $500 a bid now, six. Give me somebody to give me $600. I tell you what, I'll make it easy for everybody. Let's go five and a half. Who give me five and a half now, five and a half? Who give me five and a half now, five and a half now, five and a half? Will you give me five and a half? I got $500 a bid now, five and a half. Thank you very much, ma'am. $500 now, six. $600, $600 a bid now, six, ma'am. Back to you, $600. $600 a bid, let's go $600. Husband's talking, she's listening, husband's making, she says, 600, let's go 600. Will you give me 600? I got 500 a bid now, five and a half now, six. Will you give me 600? 600 a bid. Sir, will you do six, will you do 575? Don't look away, look forward, let's go. Do you wanna play, sir? 575, ma'am? 575, I got five and a half now, 575. Five and a half now going once. Five and a half now going twice. You're looking at me, sir, like, do you want to go? I'll be happy to send you. You can sit right next to Jim. 575? Thank you, ma'am. 600, ma'am. 600 to you, ma'am. 600. No? Oh, it's $25. Come on. It's 25. I seen you in the silent auction. You were lighting it up over there. Go 600, it's only 25 bucks. Give me 600, I need 600 bid. Let's go 600, 600 a bid, now six. 575, now six, going once. You're gonna go, guys should've went ahead and bid on that. 575, going twice, all through, all done. So 575, your direction, ma'am. Thank you very, very much, 575. All right, just want to say thank you all so much for bidding on the live auction. Don't forget your silent auction over and through there. We got some great items. A lot of items still need to be bid on. Thank you all very much. Enjoy yourself. Scott, back to you, sir.
And you thought that was going to be easy, huh, Chuck? Yeah. Thanks, my friend. Well done. Well, ladies and gentlemen, we're going to go ahead and start with our program. Again, we're delighted that you all have chosen to spend time with us here in good old Fort Worth, Texas on this Saturday night for our National Multicultural Western Heritage Museum, our annual awards banquet. And this is a special time, and a lot of special folks you're going to get a chance to meet, and we'll certainly remember many people that have been here a part of this induction event here in years past. What I'd like to do right now is just certainly make note of the incredible folks that have really anteed up and helped us so that we could bring this to fruition tonight. They really were most supportive. The recognition of our 2022 Hall of Fame induction program. These are our sponsors. Stephen Heap, 2003 Hall of Fame inductee and a member of the board of directors of the museum. Stephen, we thank you for your great support. Gold sponsor, Fort Worth Stock Show and Rodeo. Our silver sponsors, Wrangler, Texas Capital Bank, and HEB. Our bronze sponsors are the following: BNSF Railway, that's right, Burlington Northern, Santa Fe, Domingo Garcia Law Office, Frost Bank, the good folks at Hillwood, Jim Austin Online, Kelly Hart, Linebarger, Texas Christian University, Visit Fort Worth, Trinity Metro, and What's Up Fort Worth. And last but certainly not least, our Buckaroo table sponsor, Anthony Brubaker, who is a member of this year's Hall of Fame class. Let's put our hands together and thank them all. Also, I don't have a list here in front of me, but are there any city officials or state dignitaries that are here with us? Because normally in the past, we usually have some folks that are here and drop by and say hello. If you get a chance, you'll see a great message from Maddie Parker in the opening of your program. She's our mayor here in Fort Worth, so we thank Maddie and her support. But anybody else, don't be bashful. Stand up, just wave your hand and say who you are. Nobody here? Okay, good. Well, they're busy baking things, get things straightened out there so we don't have to pay $5 gas anymore. That's what they're doing. Who knows what we're doing out there. But we thank all of our great supporters, our city and state dignitaries who in years past have always been most supportive, and we thank them all for that. Also, we'd like to make note of the recognition of some National Multicultural Western Heritage Museum Hall of Fame alumni who are here with us tonight. Uh-oh, the boss is coming up. Is that my check? Oh, okay. All right. I was going to say, I haven't even finished yet. Is he here? Is he here? Where is he?
You took a picture with him earlier.
Oh, yeah, what am I thinking? Yeah, where is he, though? I don't see him back here. Where's Steve Murren? Oh,
I'm a mayor.
This guy is not a mayor. He's iconic. You ever heard of the expression icon? This is a Fort Worth, Texas icon, ladies and gentlemen. Our good friend, Steve Murren. And where were you? Weren't you in the class of what, 2015, 2016, something like that? I think it was 2015, Steve. Well, it's always good to see you. Thanks for being here, Steve. We much appreciate it. Well, that's great. All right. Well, the next thing we're going to do is make note of some of our alums that are here from years past. Also, over and above Steve, we've got Stephen Heap. Please stand and be recognized as I call your name. He's right here at this table, table four. 2003 induction. How about Art Burton, 2008, the class of 2008. Art, stand up and say hello. Harold Cash, class of 2010, right over here. And I'm proud to say that the next one is the class of 2017. I was inducted by Jim and Gloria back in 2017, and most proud to be a part of it. And last but certainly not least, we're going back 1 year, Lynn Hart. Lynn, stand up and say hello. Where's Lynn? She's at the restroom? Well, that's what I meant. But when he comes back, do me a favor. Let's just an incredible round of applause. Okay? He'll have no idea what the devil's going on. So if you see him walk in, just start applauding. Okay. All right, let's see. What do we got here? All right. I do want to be serious here for just a minute, because since we all last met for our Hall of Fame alumni get together, we have lost a couple of folks since last year's induction. Vincent Jacobs, who was the class of 2014, and Arthur Artie Mortis, class of 2018, unfortunately are deceased since we last met, and we certainly keep them in our thoughts and prayers. But let's have just a moment of silence for them both. Good, thank you very much. All right, well, let's move on now to the reason we're all gathered here tonight, and that's to induct some more to this incredible Hall of Fame, this incredible museum, and all that Jim and Gloria have continued to do over the course of the last 18 years. What I'd like to do is draw your attention to the new video screens that we have up here and take a look at why we all gather here tonight. It's a little museum marketing piece, but it really kind of tells a story for those of you that have not been a part of this in the past and might not have even been to the museum to see what goes on there every single day. So go ahead and roll the videotape.
We do a rodeo twice a year, one during the historic stock show, which is always on Martin Luther King's birthday, and then we do one during the summer. The fourth Saturday in July is the National Day of the American Cowboy. So we always do a rodeo and we do our Hall of Fame induction ceremony. We have over 120 inductees into the National Multicultural Western Heritage Museum that tells the past, present, and future of the history of the cowboy.
The museum offers our youth Western Heritage workshop, and those are programs that we invite school children to attend. They come Wednesday through Friday. We do two classes a day. We invite individuals who are actual historians to come in and talk about Western history and culture.
I think you're at the museum, Dave. Teach that is up that greater part of history so the young people to see their past and so they'll influence their future.
Because it took the past to get us to where we are today, so we should not forget that. And I'm very proud of all the museums that are taking the time to make an investment into the past history and teach the story so that the next generation can experience it and understand the contributions that were made by those before them.
The museum essentially promotes and preserves an important part of our history. And I think really gives a voice to those forgotten cowboys.
The fact of the matter is that the tourism ministry all over the world is looking for things that are genuine, that are real.
One of my goals is that if somebody scratches their head and says, no, I didn't know that, then mission accomplished. I would hope that somebody would learn something that they didn't know when they walked in the door.
Please come visit the National Multicultural Western Heritage Museum. We're located at 2029 North Main Street, Fort Worth, Texas, 76164, located in the historic Fort Worth stock floor.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, that gives you a little idea of what goes on every single day here in Fort Worth. What Gloria and Jim put together many years ago, almost two decades ago. It's hard to believe. That's an incredible legacy in itself. But it really is special. Some of the people that have been honored over the course of the years, and many of you have come to know these people, and we're going to introduce to you some people tonight that many of us have known for decades. Maybe we saw them in Hollywood, maybe we saw them wherever it might have been. But they just made a difference in the lives of those that need it most, and they really continued to be just great leaders and courageously move forward with their own lives, and that's why they're all a part of the museum, and certainly more importantly tonight, the Hall of Fame. We're going to move on tonight. We have nine people. A couple of them are going to be inducted posthumously, passed away unfortunately before we knocked on their door and said we need to have you be a part of this incredible endeavor. But I think you'll understand that it's really it's very, very special. And each and every year a video is put together before we introduce the actual recipient of the Hall of Fame Award. So we're going to start in no particular order. We're going to start off with our first video. It's Deborah Aiken Townsend. And so I want you to watch the video screens, and we'll move forward with our first inductee this year.
A cowgirl of distinction, Women's Professional Rodeo Association barrel racer, Deborah Aiken Townsend, was the object of national attention in the early 1990s when she became the first African-American woman to qualify for a major rodeo finals, the International Finals Rodeo. However, shortly thereafter, she left the competitive circuit to devote her full attention to raising her family. Born in Rockford, Illinois, the rodeo lifestyle, or owning a horse, was a mere fantasy until she became an adult.
Didn't really know what I wanted to do with a horse until I came in contact with my first husband's niece, who was a barrel racer. I didn't know what barrel racing was, I didn't know anything about rodeo, but I went with her to one rodeo and it was on. That was like, oh my gosh, I want to do this.
After being introduced to this new world, Deborah purchased several horses and underwent many years of training. It quickly became apparent that this would be no part-time hobby for Deborah. She was on a mission to become the best barrel racer that she could become.
I ultimately went through a whole lot of training and several horses to find one that I could, you know, a few years down the road, go compete on. It'll take me to my grave. It's just what I love.
In 1984, her rodeo career began. And within 4 years, success came on the Bill Pickett Invitational Rodeo Circuit, where she was barrel racing champion for three consecutive years, as well as the all-around champion for 1989 and 1990. In 1989, Aiken joined the International Professional Rodeo Association, where she immediately won the Western Region Barrel Racing Championship and finished second for Rookie of the Year honors. Deborah also finished the year ranked in the top 20 in the world championship standings.
I am proud of the accomplishments that I made because there was a lot of hard work. There were a lot of sacrifices I made. I'm at that place in my life where I'm that dreamer who I got to live out this journey, but now the part that I'm living out is helping future or new dreamers experience what their goals are.
Although three of her children competed in rodeos throughout the junior and high school rodeo ranks, only her eldest son, Lee Aiken, made rodeo a full-time profession like his mother. Deborah's barrel racing career remains her primary focus. She is an active member of the United States Tennis Association, where she plays league tennis and enjoys attending pro tournaments. As an active member of the Women's Professional Rodeo Association and the National Barrel Horse Association, Deborah continues to compete at barrel races and rodeos. Currently, Deborah lives in Agua Dulce, California, with her husband, Stuart Townsend. When she's not vigorously training and riding in preparation for her next event, she spends time training several up-and-coming future barrel racers.
I'm just happy to be a part of that. I'm happy that God's giving me that little calling in my life. It's what keeps me going today.
Mm-hmm.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'm going to ask that, here they come. Gloria and Jim will be handing out the awards this evening, as they always do. So as they make their way up here, I would also like to introduce to you and have her make her way up here as well, Deborah Aiken Townsend, our first recipient.
Good evening. Good evening. They mentioned I'm a barrel racer. I am not a public speaker, so I had to make some notes. So I have a lot in my heart about this. I'm honored to be here tonight and grateful for this recognition. I'm also really glad to have the privilege to share our beloved traditions, rich history, and Western heritage with all of you. It's become a real important part of my life. Bear with me. You can tell a great deal about a country and a people by what they deem important enough to remember, what they put in their museums, and what they celebrate. The National Western Heritage Museum has made great strides to honor a variety of people who have made the settling of the West what it is, and bringing our story to an ever-expanding group of people. The fact that this museum exists proves that we are not limited by other people's limited imaginations. Today was my first day there, and I was just astounded by the bits of history that I wasn't even aware of. Spreading the news about the contributions of so many in the settling of the West displays our history for all to see and enriches the fabric of America. Rodeo, Western heritage, and history belong to us all. And my hope is that the work that we do to preserve and share this rich and wonderful tradition will be our legacy for generations to come. This organization creates a space for young and old alike to explore avenues that maybe they didn't know were possible. It's a wonderful thing when a person finds that welcoming place where they belong, and truly a great thing when they discover a history that inspires and includes them. When young people see themselves represented, they're motivated to try harder, to achieve more, and to reach for bigger dreams. As Olympian Wilma Rudolph said, "Never underestimate the power of dreams and their influence on the human spirit." Together, our legacy reaches much farther, and our influence touches so many more lives than any one of us could do alone. Thank you again for this wonderful honor, and I'm grateful to be a part of this amazing community. I'm thrilled that together we have been able to create a legacy that will last for generations to come. Thank you.
Well done, Deborah. Great way to kick things off, and thanks for your kind words. Well put. So thank you so much. Delighted to have you be a part of this the class this year in 2022 as we move forward. Wasn't she great? Yes. Well, we go from Deborah to a name that I'm sure many of you probably know, whether you were in rodeo or wherever it might have been. If I were to say the name Harry Belafonte, what comes to mind? Well, I'll tell you what. Been around a long, long time. I looked it up on my phone. I think he's 95 years old now. Is that unbelievable or what? Incredible. Incredible legacy indeed. And once again, please watch the video screens to learn more.
Harry Belafonte, born March 1, 1927 in Harlem in New York City, is an American singer, songwriter, activist, and actor. One of the most successful Jamaican-American pop stars, as he popularized the Trinbandonian Caribbean music style with an international audience in the 1950s. His breakthrough album, Calypso, was the first million-selling LP by a single artist. Author historian Art Burton has followed Belafonte's career for many years.
But I started playing hand drums, African percussion, at the age of 10. And Harry was one of the first people I seen with hand drummers on television playing his calypso music. And that had a big influence on me as a youngster.
Belafonte is known for his recording of the Banana Boat song with its signature lyric, Deo.
Work all night on a drink of rum.
He has recorded and performed in many genres, including blues, folk, gospel, show tunes, and American standards. Early on, he has also starred in several films, including Carmen Jones.
What a mosquito bite.
Island in the Sun, Odds Against Tomorrow, and the widely known and studied for its political relevance, Buck and the Preacher.
I put my faith in the good book.
A film he produced and starred in with Sir Sidney Poitier, the film's director. His list of discographies, stage work, filmography, and television work is extensive and covers the 1950s to the current year of 2022. Belafonte considered the actor, singer, and activist Paul Robeson a mentor and was a close confidant of Dr. Reverend Martin Luther King Jr. in the civil rights movement in the 1950s and 1960s.
I would think his efforts at trying to assist people of color and people who are oppressed probably is his greatest legacy of the last 30 years or so.
Belafonte has been an advocate for political and humanitarian causes, such as the anti-apartheid movement and USA for Africa. Since 1987, he has been a UNICEF Goodwill Ambassador. Belafonte has won 3 Grammy Awards, including a Grammy Lifetime Achievement Award, an Emmy Award, and a Tony Award.
And I'm glad the National Multicultural Western Heritage Museum is putting him in the Hall of Fame for his efforts, particularly with Buck and the Preacher.
Harry Belafonte, 95 years old, an incredible legacy. I'm going to ask Art Burton if he would please come forward, and he is going to be the recipient of this award and get it to Harry. So let's put our hands together for Art. Come on up.
Harry told me to go straight to the mic. I think they got me to do this because me and Harry's hairline is kind of similar. But this is great. I mean, I remember Harry playing clips of music back in the day. He was one of the first people that had hand drummers, and I played bongo drums at the age of 10, so it was a big influence on me. But Harry's always been one of the most consistent people. We're talking about the oppression of people of color. And at 95, he's still doing it. And Harry's been a big influence on a lot of people in the arts, be it film, music, or dealing with civil rights, or whatsoever. And so this is a great honor. Bucking the Preacher, which he starred with Sidney Poitier, is still the number one black Western that Hollywood has made. And I think Harry did a yeoman's job in terms of his acting abilities in that movie. And this is quite an honor for him to be placed in the museum. And I'm sure that we can all celebrate the legacy of Harry Belafonte. And I'm very happy to accept the award for him. Thank you very much.
All right, so we go from Deborah to Harry Belafonte, and our thanks to Art Burton, who was, has accepted and shared with us some words on behalf of Harry as we move forward. Those are two of the nine people that we'll be honoring here this evening. Good, thanks again, Art, well done. We appreciate you being here. Next, ladies and gentlemen, we move on to inductee number three and ask you to turn to the video screen as we say hello to Anthony Tony Brubaker.
Anthony Brubaker was born in New Orleans, Louisiana in 1946. At age 9, his parents moved to Los Angeles, California.
I fell in love with horses when I was about 12, 14 years old. I was got, you know, when a kid loves something, it's not a job, it's not a chore, it's something you love doing. Riding horses was what I loved.
Anthony Tony Brubaker is a former Hollywood stuntman, stunt coordinator, and actor. Standing at 6'3", Brubaker had his first experience in the industry when he doubled Otis Young in the ABC Western, The Outcasts. The year was 1969, and it was a time when most cowboys were portrayed as white, when throughout the West, there were large numbers of black, indigenous, and cowboys of color in the real world. One of the many struggles that a stunt person of color encountered during the 60s was instead of casting black stuntmen, Hollywood directors hired white males and painted their faces to perform the stunts of black actors.
They had a white guy painted down to Double Rochester driving the taxi. And he said, why don't you use black stuntmen? And he said, bring me one.
The white stunt group would not let us in. We had to be 150% better than the white guys.
We showed we had the expertise.
Tony was able to associate with a powerful organization, the Black Stuntmen's Association, which formed out of a necessity to break down these barriers and ultimately resulted in paving the way for many of today's black entertainers in front of and behind the camera.
Hopefully, I've served as a good example for men and women of color, black, white, brown, behind me to come home and say, well, if he did it, I think I can do it too.
Tony has worked in over 325 productions across the globe and done it all from crashing cars, motorcycle stunts,
fire burns, fights, and high falls.
In the motion picture business, you're only as good as your last job.
One of his most memorable stunts was from Blown Away, filmed in 1995, starring Tommy Lee Jones, Jeff Bridges, and Forrest Whitaker. Tony is extremely proud and honored to have doubled many notable actors such as Sidney Poitier, Louis Gossett Jr., Greg Morris, Danny Glover, Harry Belafonte, Bill Duke, Mr. T, Richard Roundtree, James Earl Jones, Dennis Haysbert, just to name a few.
First of all, I was blessed. The Lord gave me this body. He gave me some physical talents, and it was all Him. He just put me in the right place at the right time. If it's something you love, it's never a job. It's something that you love doing. Get your education. Get the education. They can take everything. They can take your arms, your legs, but they can't take your education. You can do anything as long as you've got it in here.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Anthony Tony Brubaker.
I tell you what, not being a public speaker, this is a heck of a place to be. As you guys have seen, I've done a lot of hell-raising things. Up here is, I'm going 90 miles an hour. But anyway, you know, like I said, and I've always thought that I was blessed to have the family I do, to have the Lord that I do, and the body that He gave me, and be able to do what I have done. I do it, and I'm able to see young kids come behind me and say, if he did it, I can do it. I'm tickled to death to do that. I've got my son, my wife, my grandson, brother-in-law, sister-in-law, a lot of brother-in-laws and sister-in-laws in here, friends and neighbors, and I am tickled to death to be here meeting a whole lot of new friends and new people. The museum is a wonderful place. Again, to further what I was working towards from 69 till a couple of years ago. My mind says I can still do it. And your body says, yeah, go ahead and try it, boy, if you want to. Yeah, I did it in Harriet. And when I did, I wound up going to hospital for getting sewn up my arm and stuff. But I don't mind that. I'll do it again. If I had to live this life all over again, I'd do it exactly as I did it. I'd endure all the hurts and the injuries and stuff. No big deal. We just keep going because my kids, my grandkids, your grandkids will see that they can do it too. And like I say, you got the Lord in your life and you got something He gave us right in here. Develop this. If you've got this, it's wonderful. If you don't, this will never let you down. And I have been blessed with it. And again, I thank the museum, the Austins. It's an honor to be here. And again, I thank the museum and all of you folks too. Thank you very much.
Well, for a guy that's not a public speaker, I thought he did a pretty good job, didn't he? Yeah. And I like what he said about using this up here. Unfortunately, too many people in our crazy world don't do that enough, and he certainly has given us some good advice for our younger generation to look up to and always believe in themselves that they can get it done. Tony Brubaker, we thank you very much. Our third inductee of the night. Now we move on to number four, ladies and gentlemen. Again, we ask you to watch the video screens as we say hello to Reginald T. Dorsey. For those of you that couldn't hear him, Tony just mentioned, oh my gosh, I forgot to mention my daughter. She's at a different table. Hey, Tony, I simply say to you, been there, done that. We understand, you know? Yeah. Got the whole clan there. All right. Where's your daughter? Please stand up. You're absolutely adorable. See, that's what happens when dad forgets you, then you get your own stand-up, see? So it pays off in the end. All right, let's not take anything away from number four, Reginald T. Dorsey.
Reginald T. Dorsey is an award-winning American film and television actor, filmmaker. He was born and raised in Dallas, Texas, where he says the cowboy way of life was in his blood.
My parents saw that I had a great passion for horses, and you know, I wasn't gonna let them not get me one, so I just bugged them, and finally, you know, at the age of six, my dad showed up one day with a pony in the back of his U-Haul trailer, and that was one of the best days of my life. And it's been nonstop ever since.
When he was 10 years old, his family moved to San Jose, California, where he was an outstanding student and high school athlete, excelling in football and track. However, the quest for him to act proved to be more powerful than his athletic dreams. After attending an open call with his mother, Tenora, back in Dallas for extra work in the film Book of Numbers, filmmaker Raymond St. Jacques spotted the young 13-year-old and wrote a lead part for him in the film.
I actually got my first job at 13, but I left home at 16. And from that point on, you know, I hit the ground running, and it was pretty much, you know, just focused on the craft itself, of that of an actor.
The rest is history, as they say. And at 16 years old, he left home for Hollywood to pursue his calling as an actor and filmmaker.
I'm sorry, man. My nerves are kind of bad right now.
Now a veteran in the film and TV business, his respect and passion for his craft is even greater after many years of sacrifice and dedication.
We've been friends for I can't even remember how long now, because he's quite a gentleman. He believes the cowboy way. He's a true Texan. We get into that all the time, me being a true New Yorker. he's a true Texan and a downright cowboy.
His credits are extensive. Miracle of the Heart, A Boy's Town Story, 21 Jump Street, Booker, Return to Lonesome Dove, Fifth Ward, the critically acclaimed South Central, and the award-winning Kings of the Evening, which he also produced.
As an actor and filmmaker, it's important to have as many skills as possible, because they can all contribute to a performance and to an artist's longevity within the entertainment business as a filmmaker and as an actor.
A third-generation true Texas cowboy his whole life, Reginald's other passions include teaching riding lessons, training and raising horses, competing in rodeos, most notably the Bill Pickett Invitational, where he is co-grand marshal. Dorsey has also won championships in team roping and team pinning. His work with children and touching people's lives in a meaningful way continues to be a source of inspiration for him as an artist and as a man, giving all glory to the Great Spirit for his many blessings.
I just want to say thank you to my family. I want to say thank you to my friends that have been there for me through the ups and the downs And I'm still here, still grinding.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome our fourth recipient in the class of 2022, Reginald T. Dorsey.
Good evening, everyone. I'm having a very surreal moment right now because a year and a half ago, I had a serious medical condition and I was fighting for my life to simply be here. And the Great Spirit is wonderful because I'm here and I'm being celebrated tonight. So. You know, it's just amazing how quickly things can turn around when you believe and when you have faith. And I want to first acknowledge all the other inductees. Congratulations for you coming into the National Western Heritage Museum and all that they contribute to our culture. I was born and raised in Dallas, Texas. And before my family moved to San Jose, California, we lived in Fort Worth. And I'll never forget those hot summers where I would literally walk 5 miles to shovel horse manure to work at a stable for 50 cents a day. And I remember when I used to have my lunch break, I'd take that 50 cents and walk across the street to the store. I'd get me a can of potted meat, some crackers, and a pickle. And I did that because once my parents split up, I wasn't around my horse. And so I still had that drive and that will to just want to be around horses and cowboys. And fortunately for me, working at the stable, I'd stay later into the evening and I would push calves out for the calf ropers. And I met an African-American cowboy. And that cowboy became my role model. And his memory, I don't know his name, but his memory stays with me forever. And it has helped to motivate me, to drive me. And it's just one of those situations where you never know whose life you're gonna touch, what kind of impression you're gonna leave on someone. And after we'd get through, you know, working the cattle that night, he'd take me home. You know, and drop me off safely to my mom, you know. I want to thank my mother for her encouragement throughout my career, you know, both as a cowboy and as a filmmaker and actor. My stepdad, L.B. Wallace, and my dad, you know, Willie Dorsey, for bringing me my first horse, you know, in that U-Haul trailer. you know, basically, this museum represents an iconic establishment that those of us who are a part of it will continue to celebrate, continue to let people know that it exists. And it's important for me, you know, that I acknowledge my ancestors, who without them I wouldn't be here. My grandfather was a cowboy, Henry Young. His son, my uncle, Wardell Young, he put me on my first horse at 3 years old. And their blood lives through me, and I hope to continue to pass it on to generations to come. I'd like to acknowledge my students, some of my students that are here, that have trained with me. And for friends of mine that drove all the way cross country to be here, AJ Lopez and his family. They drove all the way out from California just to be here for this event. And that table over there is all my family. You know? Yeah, my aunts and, you know, my cousins and of course, my mother, Tenora Young Dorsey. And I just want to thank you guys for your support, your love. And let's continue to encourage one another and to inspire one another and to represent the cowboy way, because, again, it is one that that is held in great regards. It's one to be respected because we live by a certain ethic and a certain code, and we need that more so than at any other time right now, in my humble opinion. So let's continue to represent and be proud of the boots that we wear, the spurs that we wear, and the hats that we wear, and you know, the lives that we touch along the way. So thank you very much. I appreciate you and I love you.
Now, Reginald talked about his family. I think half the people in here, for Pete's sake, are in your family. But I do want to find out, where is his mom? Mom, can you stand up? There's Mom. Well, you done well, Mom. You did a good job. You did a good job. We need more moms like you in this world today. So good for you. Well done. And Reginald? Well done. Congratulations. Reginald T. Dorsey, ladies and gentlemen. Now we move on and we get to recipient number 5. Watch the video screens and we say hello to Danny Glover.
Accomplished actor, producer, film director, political activist, and humanitarian, Danny Glover has been a commanding presence on the screen, stage, and television for more than 30 years. As an actor, his film credits range from the blockbuster Lethal Weapon franchise to smaller independent features, some of which Danny also produced. Glover says for him, acting is transformative.
When I think about acting, it's from that vantage point. Where does the character begin? Example for, there's a place where you can make choices. Usually the strongest choice is that you want to be loved. That's a strong one. So love has always had to do something. So love gives you the possibility of transformation.
In 2018, during the 49th NAACP Image Awards, Danny Glover was honored with the President's Award for being a true inspiration who always uses his celebrity status to advance the cause of social justice and respect for a diverse society. The actor, who has spent decades involved with community and labor activism, advocating for economic justice and education, was honored for his work in film and TV.
Look at you. You're black, you're poor, you're ugly, you're a woman, you're nothing at all.
The Color Purple star continues to lend his celebrity to causes that matter, make an impact, spark social change, and create dialogue. Glover has portrayed a myriad of popular roles and has distinguished himself as one of his generation's most consummate actors. Glover's performances in such classic motion pictures as Witness and Places in the Heart have not only displayed his talent and versatility, but have also brought him critical and audience acclaim. Honored with awards from the NAACP, BET, and SAG. On March 25th, 2022, the Academy of Motion Pictures, Arts, and Sciences honored Mr. Glover with the Jean Hersholt Humanitarian Award at the Governor's Award Ceremony. Of the numerous prestigious accolades he has received, Glover also received nominations for 4 Primetime Emmy Awards, 4 Grammy Awards, and a Daytime Emmy Award.
I will not leave South Africa, nor will I surrender.
Off screen, Glover has gained respect for his wide-reaching community activism and philanthropic efforts. Internationally, Danny Glover has served as a goodwill ambassador for the United Nations Development Program, focusing on issues of poverty, disease, and economic development in Africa, Latin America, and the Caribbean. He was appointed UNICEF Goodwill Ambassador in 2004. In 2013, Danny was presented with the Audrey Hepburn Humanitarian Award, honoring him for his decades-long advocacy on behalf of the most vulnerable children.
To be inducted into the Hall of Fame with so many women and men who devoted their lives and the passion for what they do, the work that they do. That's about it, because it's work. But I'm honored to be inducted to the Hall of Fame.
Ladies and gentlemen, unfortunately, Danny Glover could not be with us tonight, but I'm going to get Jim Austin to come up here and say a few words, or at least accept the award on his behalf.
Y'all can clap for me. I don't mind. You know, this is, you know, our 18th annual Hall of Fame induction ceremony, and sometimes when I get to talking about what we're doing here today, this morning from 10 o'clock to 11 o'clock, I think we moved another page in the history of celebrating the diversity of the West. And I was so blessed to talk to all the Hall of Famers to let them know that we were bringing them in the hall. And, you know, I don't want to start tearing up, but it just moves my heart. You know, Gloria and I have been married for 25 years, and this is our labor of love. It's my passion. And I talked to Mr. Glover this morning, and he's at a family reunion. And he said, Jim, you can go ahead and give me a call, and I might pick up or I might be at the picnic. So we're going to call him and see if he picks up right now, you know. And he gave me that permission. And the first time I talked to him, I was at the kitchen table and got his cell number. And you know, if you give Jim your cell number, you'll hear from me at any time. So when I called him, it was early in the morning, and he was half asleep. So I told him that we want to honor him. And
you reached me at area code 510-368-0022. Leave your name, message, and number, and I will return your call. Thank you.
The mailbox is full and cannot accept.
Now, he might call back, so okay, because he said, Jim, call me today, and I called him before I came up here. But, you know, Lethal Weapon, Buffalo Soldier, you know, all the movies that Danny's been in is just phenomenal and leading the way as an African-American actor. And I told my wife when I talked to him, I mean, Gloria was at the end of the table, and she was just, that's Danny Glover. I said, yep, that's him. Just a good guy. What do you call it? Called him, Reginald T. Dorsey called him and told him he needed to be here. This morning I mentioned Tony Brubaker, and Tony, he said, give you his regards, because he represented him as a stuntman. But you talk about a real, real hero. So, if he calls back, I'll stop the program and y'all can talk to him. Because when you hear the voice, it's Danny Glover. And he lives in Oakland, and he says, hey, I just enjoy living here on the beach, and I don't move too often. But I did talk to him this morning. And yesterday was his birthday. Yeah, mm-hmm, had a birthday. So he doing good, he hanging out with his family. And he said he wanted to come hang out with me, but he had already made commitments before I called him. So I want to thank all the inductees. And, you know, this is just a great page. Every 18th, every one of them gets bigger and bigger and bigger. And all of them, as soon as I met them, they start picking on me. You know, and I said, why does everybody pick on Jim Austin? Am I that kind of guy to receive that? Oh, okay. See, she's saying it's time to shut it down. Congratulations, Danny Glover, and for being here.
All right, thank you, Jim, and certainly our congratulations to Danny Glover. All right, you know the drill. Ladies and gentlemen, please watch the video screens. Next up, Albert, Al, and S.E. Morris.
The stars at night are big and bright, deep in the heart of Texas. Blue ones blue, sweet.
Albert Al Morris was born on February 19, 1938. In Temple, Texas. After growing up in Temple, Al served in the United States Air Force, after which, in the late 50s, he moved to Los Angeles, California to work as a guitarist. He played in the esteemed backup band The People, which opened for major headliners including James Brown, The Coasters, The Motown Luminaries, and more. He also played for the legendary Etta James for 5 years. Returning home to Texas in the late 70s, Al ran a photography business, capitalizing on an expertise developed in the service. And then Al met Essie, who would become his wife, and for 40 years now, the other half of Mr. and Mrs. Country Soul.
You travel down some dusty roads, slept out in the rain, but this yellow rose is always here when you come.
Essie Pearl Robinson was born on June 14, 1935, in Forest City, North Carolina, one of 11 children. Her father, the Reverend Milton Robinson, was a minister in the African Methodist Episcopal Zion Church, as well as a newspaper publisher and editor. After graduating high school, Essie attended Livingstone College in North Carolina, majoring in biology, and also playing varsity basketball for the school's undefeated team. In 1975, Essie moved to Temple, Texas, and continued working in education, counseling, and school administration. She also earned an MS in science education from Fisk University. After her first marriage had ended, Essie met Al, and in 1980, they started a newspaper together, the Syntex Motion, featuring minority news and views of Central Texas.
One day we were sitting in the office working on a deadline, and he said, he started singing Cotton Fields Back Home. When I was a little bit afraid, Mom used to rock me in the old cotton fields back home. And I started to harmonize. And he looked up at my desk, he said, Essie, I said, yes. He said, let's start a band. And I thought he was getting fresh with me or something. I said, I beg your pardon? He said, let's start a band. And I said, this rascal's trying to see if I can keep up with him. Well, I'm an old physics chemistry teacher, blah, blah, blah. So I said, all right, I'm game.
And the rest is history. Both Al and Essie had grown up listening to country music and also had other musical backgrounds. Al was an accomplished guitar player with a beautiful, deep, gravelly voice. And Essie had been singing all her life in the choir of her father's rural church.
Music will calm a wild beast.
But making people happy is the main thing. And honestly, it couldn't be more delightful.
Their unique sound thus integrated elements of gospel and blues into a wide-ranging country repertoire. The Academy of Country Music recognized the duo in 1984. Writing that Al and Essie add a special soulful feeling to their deliveries. Several original songs, such as Buzzards in the Family, and There's Something About Music appear on the Alan S.E. Morris YouTube channel.
We got buzzards in the family picking bones. We got buzzards in the family picking bones.
Now in their mid-80s, Alan S.E. continued to perform and write songs and entertain audiences on a regular basis.
They're meeting the needs of a lot of people with what they're doing up there in Fort Worth. And we are honored to be a part of it. Sure, we've been in Las Vegas. We've sung all over America. But this is an honor that we have never thought about acquiring. And that is to be inducted in the Hall of Fame.
From sea to shining sea, Texas.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Albert Allen, S.E. Morris.
Kind of filled up, and after what happened tonight, we had a little unfortunate experience with our equipment. We don't know what happened. After we practiced and set it up, went upstairs to get dressed and came back, my mic was over here on another table. We don't know what it was, but all I can say is I've got goose pimples all over, and I'm thankful to God for this couple. Who are you? And I tell her she is my mentor. I might be older than she is. I'm 87, but she's not anything near me. But the whole thing centers around the fact that she set an example that I want to follow. I have an addiction. I can't deny it. And my addiction is young people. I can't help it. They're in my blood, in my body. And although I've been traveling with Al, and he and I have been singing all these years, young people know. I can't resist them. They have stolen my heart forever. I met a young lady today. Where are you, young lady? Where are you? She's somewhere in this audience. And she's a senior. And I said, listen, wherever you want to go to school, so what are you going to major in? She said, biology. So I said, why? She said, I want to become a doctor. I said, please, let me know. Fisk University is right across the street from Meharry Medical School. And if I can, I'll get you in both of them. The whole thing centers around what the National Science Foundation did for me, just like what you people, all of you, are doing for us right now. And the world of music is beautiful. It says something. It tells a story. My lovely daughter drove off, came all the way up from Atlanta. And all I can say is I'm thankful to God that she's here. I have two beautiful children to be thankful for. And I'm thankful to be here, all of you. I don't know names, but I see faces. And all I can say is you make me smile inside and out. I'm 87 years old, and I know it. My time's winding up. But I've had a good time on this earth. I have had a good time on this earth. This caps the stack. That's all I can say. Although this is my tutu.
I've been called a lot. Well, shut up. I'm 84 years old. She's 87. She robbed the cradle when she married me, but you know that. That was fun. But I have been, we have been playing, singing music together for 40 years. We own a newspaper, and we own a newspaper called the Syntax Motion out of Temple, Texas. And what after we got the newspaper going, we decided we want to play some music. So we came in as the Texas Cotton Pickers Association. They thought we were a big organization. It wasn't a big organization. It was just two of us. So anyway, we were the Academy of Country Music heard us in Los Angeles, and when they did hear us, they changed our name to Mr. and Mrs. Country Soul. It was 1984. And so we've been Mr. and Mrs. Country Soul since 1984. But anyway, we had a good time. We've met a lot of people. We've done a lot of things that we never thought was possible. But we love people. We love entertaining people. And we've had some times, I can't even tell you the good times, the things we've done, and things been done to us. You know, for instance, we had played in on the East Coast, and we're coming back, and we need a place to stay, so the police department said, okay, you go down this street here, go down here, too, and we'll put you up there, and you can have a good place to stay and not worry about anything. At 4 o'clock in the morning, somebody knocked on the door, and I went to the door and opened the door, and there was a lady standing there. She said, I said, what you need, ma'am? She said, I'm looking for my husband. I said, your husband? You see, and by that time, my wife jumped up. She said, there's nobody that's helping here but mine. So, but a foot came to the door, and 4 policemen came in with shotguns and pushed us on the bed and laid us down on the bed and put shotguns at our heads and asked, where's this money? All right. We got over it. They got over it. But I'm just saying, there's things happen in life that you let. Our music went out a while ago. Our music went out, and we said, wait a minute. When I was playing with Elder James, playing with Sam and Dave, different people, thing would happen. And we said, first thing we said was S-O-B, S. I didn't mean that. S-A-B-E-R-T-O-D-G-E, sabotage. Said S-O-B. S-A, excuse my language. I'm having a good time up here. And I hope you are too. But again, I'm going to let you go. And thank you for everything.
What do you think? That's a sitcom waiting to happen, isn't it? Oh my gosh. They are rare. Just wonderful. That's Al and Essie Morris, ladies and gentlemen. And all that applause is for the two of you. Well done. Well done. Just be safe getting back home. All right. Time to check out those video screens again, ladies and gentlemen. Our number 7th recipient, inductee here in the class of 2022, Chris Navarro.
Chris Navarro has always wanted to be a cowboy. He got his first horse when he was just 12 years old.
I started showing horses when I was training horses when I was 13, 14.
Navarro's father was in the military and stationed at different air bases around the country.
My dad was 30 years in the military, so we were always stationed at different air bases. It's hard to grow up, you know, wanting to be a cowboy in different air bases. I went to college riding bulls, and I took 9 months off, and that's all I did was ride bulls and try to make a living out of it. It was pretty, that hurt a lot. Didn't have no money. I quit riding bulls for the same reason most all the guys quit riding bulls.
This national award-winning artist from Casper, Wyoming and Sedona, Arizona, has been sculpting professionally since 1986. Navarro cast his first sculpture when he was 23 years old.
Maybe my first sculpture was a bull rider. I won first place and won a blue ribbon. And it was a small art show, but it won $15 and, a blue ribbon.
Navarro is best known for his large public sculptures. His work is included in 12 museum collections with over 35 monumental bronze sculptures placed throughout the country. Monumental sculptures include the Ring of Peace, a 19-foot bell with doves, the Buffalo Soldier, a 10-foot cavalry soldier, champion Lane Frost, a 15-foot bull rider, a 16-foot tall bronze of the famous bucking horse Steamboat for the University of Wyoming, and the messenger for the historical Alamo Mission in San Antonio, Texas.
I liked art. It was my favorite subject in high school, but I didn't even ever thought you could make a living out of it. You know, never entered my mind. Every expert in any field was a beginner at one time. And you don't know what you can do until you try.
Navarro has authored 4 books. He was selected as the honorary artist for the 2015 Buffalo Bill Art Show in Cody, Wyoming. He also received the 2015 Wyoming Governor's Art Award and in 2018, the Distinguished Alumni Award from Casper College. In 2021, Navarro received the Legacy Award and induction into the Bull Riding Hall of Fame.
Oh, it's just a great honor, you know. I'm real blessed to be able to share my art and my story with people. And, you know, as an artist, you want to inspire people. I mean, I do. I think, you know, and it's nice to be recognized by an organization such as that.
Navarro's imagination is far-reaching.
I'm trying to repurpose wind turbine blades right now. And so they had this picture of this big bulldozer burying these huge blades, and I thought, man, what a waste of material. I want to build Windhinge, which is a copy of Stonehenge out of wind turbine blades. Not everybody has a lot of money and not everybody has a lot of education, but we all have time and desire, you know, and you put those two things together, you can do a lot.
Ladies and gentlemen, our 7th recipient tonight, Chris Navarro.
Thank you, everybody, for being here, and it's a real honor to be accepted into this great group of individuals and people that have done something that try to inspire others. And, you know, I always heard a good speech is a lot like a woman's dress. It's long enough to cover all the information, but short enough to keep you interested. So hopefully I'll get through this kind of quick, but, you know, I've been a professional artist for 37 years now, and you know, it's interesting to talk about everybody's first love was horses when they were young kids, and that was mine. I always wanted to be a cowboy. And my dad was a professional soldier, 30 years. He's a veteran of World War II, Korea and Vietnam, and he's born in Del Rio, Texas. All my family's from San Antonio, so I was kind of grew up there. When you're in the military, you don't really set down any roots. And so I moved to Wyoming in 1974. I was riding bulls at Casper College, and that's what I wanted to end up settling. I really love Wyoming. It's a great state. Not a lot of people there. That's one of the things I like about it. But anyways, you know, so I wanted to be a bull rider, and that was my real dream. And I tell people when I finally decided to quit riding bulls, I was so poor I couldn't afford to pay attention. Because, you know, one thing about bull riding, you're going to get hurt. And if you don't get hurt, you just didn't get on enough bulls, because that's the nature of that business. But I tell people, you know, and they ask me about my art career, and I say, you know what, being a bull rider was really good training for being a professional artist. And they say, well, why is that? I said, the two things you need to be a good bull rider, you need to be an artist. You need to have confidence, and you need to have faith. Because you got to have the confidence to think, yeah, I'm going to ride this big old rascal, and I ain't going to get hurt. So that helps in art business, too. And, you know, I've been making a living at it, but I didn't have any real formal art training. So it was, I was 23 years old. I saw a bronze by a famous artist named Harry Jackson from Wyoming. And it was about Steamboat, a great bucking horse from the state of Wyoming. And I saw it, and I said, that's the most beautiful thing I ever saw. I go, how much is that? And this was in 1979. He said, that's worth $35,000. I said, wow, I can't afford that. Maybe I can go make one. So the very next day, I walk into Godick's art store in Casper, and I say, I'd like to learn to be a bronze artist. Can you sell me the supplies? And they did, and I loaded them in my truck, and I drove over to the library, and I went to the librarian, and I said, give me all the books you got on sculpting. And I went home, and I was living in a little 10x55 trailer at the time, and I made my first sculpture. It was a bull rider, and it was called Spinning and Winning. And the guy at the foundry, you know, he said, that's pretty nice for your first piece. Let me enter it in this art show. And I said, all right. You know, I didn't know what to expect. But I won that blue ribbon and that $15, and I thought, I'm onto something here. I still got that blue ribbon hanging in my studio, but I spent that $15. But, you know, you never know what you can do in life, you know. And a lot of people go, oh, you're self-taught. I said, no, I'm self-educated. I don't believe anybody's self-taught. I learned from other people. I learned from looking at another artist's work. And seeing Harry's lit a spark in me to do something. And I knew I was, just something inside me wanted to make that sculpture. And people go, well, do you have any, you know, formal training? I said, well, I have a PhD in art. I was poor, I was hungry, and I was determined. And I can't believe I'm still making this good living, making art. And I keep telling my wife, I kind of feel like I'm stealing. And she goes, quit telling people that. I said, well, I'm taking from the rich and I'm giving to the poor. And I've been so blessed. And you know, the great thing of it is I've done like 35 different large monuments, and I hope to make a few more. And I hope to put one here in Fort Worth over at the Rodeo Plaza. I've been kind of talking with some people over there. And, you know, I'm real proud to have one at the Alamo. It was the first big bronze to go in there. And you never know what life's road you're going to meet in life, you know. Why my road went and took this fork to be an artist never entered my mind, you know. It just it was something that resonated inside of me. I try not to overthink things. So my secret to life is you don't know what you can do until you try. And you can do a lot when you try hard. Thank you very much. It's a big honor to be here.
Thank you, Chris, very, very much. Ladies and gentlemen, Chris Navarro. Well, as I said at the top, we have just a great lineup this year. The next two gentlemen, unfortunately, are no longer with us, but they will receive this award posthumously. And the first gentleman, and I looked it up today, and I thought, oh, my gosh, I wonder how long he's been gone. I couldn't believe it. It was 1990. It's over 30 years ago that we lost Sammy Davis Jr. But let's go back in time and look at our next video.
I knew a man, Bojangles, and he danced for you. In worn-out shoes, with silver hair, a ragged shirt, and baggy pants. He would do the old soft shoe.
Samuel George Davis Jr., known as someone who could do it all. Sing, dance, play instruments, act, stand-up comedy, was born on December 8, 1925, in Harlem, Manhattan, New York. The son of dancer Elvira Sanchez Davis
and vaudeville star Sammy Davis Sr. By the age of 4, after learning to tap, Davis began his career in vaudeville with his father in the Will Maston Trio, which toured nationally. He made his film debut in the 1932 short Rufus Jones for President, showing off the tap dancing skills taught by the legendary Bill Bojangles Robinson. A short stint in the Army opened his eyes to the evils of racism. In 1944, during World War II, Davis was drafted into the U.S. Army at age 18. He was frequently abused by white soldiers from the South and later recounted, "I must have had a knockdown, drag-out fight every 2 days." Davis, who earned the American Campaign Medal and World War II Victory Medal, was honorably discharged. Sammy Davis Jr. appeared on numerous early television shows like The Rifleman and 2 Ounces of Tin, where he showcased his fast and fancy gun spinning skills.
Kind of easing it all the way, doing flat spins and everything like that. And then finally to wind up with one of these.
As well as guest starring on several television westerns, films, and variety television shows showing off the skill.
And you can see he's got his cowboy hat on. I've got my cowgirl hat on.
Margaret Bush Ware worked for Davis Jr. as talent coordinator for 14 years. Her collection of photos and memorabilia adorns 2 rooms in her home.
I had several years of working right next to the world's greatest entertainer.
Mr. Davis helped break down racial barriers in show business in the 1950s and 1960s. Especially in Las Vegas, where he often performed. During the 1960s, he became active in the civil rights movement, participating in the 1963 March on Washington and refusing to perform at racially segregated nightclubs. But in the meantime, the multi-talented Davis maintained his musical career, releasing albums well into the late 70s, getting his first number one chart hit with 1972's The Candyman. Davis was awarded the Spingarn Medal by the NAACP and was nominated for a Golden Globe Award and an Emmy Award for his television performances. And in 2001, he was posthumously awarded the Grammy Lifetime Achievement Award. Davis died of complications from throat cancer at his home in Beverly Hills, California on May 16, 1990 at age 64.
He lived and breathed Western, so this would be an honor for him to accept the award posthumously, but even in his spirit, I'm sure will be there.
Sammy Davis Jr., one of the greatest pop culture icons of the 20th century, who earned the title Mr. Entertainer.
Is it so? Don't let me be the last to know, you know my kind of shame.
Sammy Davis Jr., certainly one of the greatest of all time. Stephen, you coming up here? Stephen Heap is going to accept this.
Well, Sammy Davis Jr., geez. Gloria contacted me and she said, would you please accept this award for him? And I said, I'm just not worthy. Growing up, I was watching that clip, and that's really my first introduction to Sammy Davis Jr. was that show, The Rifleman. And I was just so impressed with how he could handle a gun. And I followed his career, you know, beyond that. I had an uncle that was worked for the Sands Hotel in Las Vegas, and I had the opportunity to walk past him when Sammy Davis Jr. and Dean Martin were playing cards. So I don't have the convenience of waiting for a phone call from him like Jim. No. Has he called yet? But I do accept this award on his behalf. Thank you.
Thank you, Stephen, very, very much. Well, last but certainly not least, again, a posthumously induction. This is, again, one of those iconic individuals that has touched us all in some way just by watching him and all that they represented on the screen for so many years. You ready to roll? This is Sir Sidney Poitier.
To try your life.
Sir Sidney Poitier was Hollywood's first major black box office star, constantly blazing trails with film roles such as Dr. John Wade Prentice in Guess Who's Coming to Dinner, and Mark Thackeray in To Sir with Love, as well as his activism in the heart of the civil rights era. Sidney Poitier was born prematurely on February 20th, 1927, in Miami, Florida, to Evelyn and Reginald James Poitier. His birth in the United States entitled him to U.S. citizenship. Poitier grew up on Cat Island, Bahamas, where his parents owned a farm, and returned as a teenager to the United States, where he enlisted in the U.S. Army during World War II and served in a medical unit. Upon his honorable discharge, he attended the American Negro Theater in New York City. In 1946, he made his Broadway debut in Lysistrata. Poitier's first credited film role was Dr. Luther Brooks, a black doctor who treated a bigoted white criminal in the 1950 film No Way Out. The movie established a significant pattern both for Poitier himself and for the black actors who followed him by refusing roles that played to racial stereotypes.
Look, he's sick, he's crazy, he's everything you said. But I can't kill a man just because he hates me.
Actor and friend Glenn Turman remembers Poitier during his part in the stage play, Raisin in the Sun.
Looking up at him at the age of 12 on stage every night, he looked like a giant, you know. And as I got older and grew into myself, I come to realize what that meant in terms of what a giant is about.
In 1972, he made his directorial debut with Buck and the Preacher, a Western movie. Sidney Poitier, alongside actor-producer Harry Belafonte, helped rewrite the history of the Western, bringing black heroes to a genre in which they had always been sorely underrepresented.
No, it's more than just being tall. It's about being big of heart. It's about being big of mind. It's about being gracious, self-defacing. Oh, he was all of those things, and I learned much of that from him, and hopefully carry those attributes as part of my character.
They call me Mr. Tibbs.
The Bahamian American actor, director, and producer broke the color barrier in the U.S. motion picture industry by becoming the first African American to win an Academy Award for Best Actor for Lilies of the Field.
See him in the temple, talking with the elders, who marveled at his wisdom.
In life, he used his charisma and his renown as forces for change. With his talent and his tenacity, Poitier built bridges and opened doors for so many. At the same time, he was dedicated to civil rights. He was there on the steps of the Lincoln Memorial in Washington, D.C., during the March on Washington on August 28, 1963. He witnessed the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King, Jr. delivering the historic I Have a Dream speech. Poitier was the recipient of many prestigious honors, awards, and recognitions for his remarkable accomplishments as an artist and as a human being. Sir Sidney Poitier passed from this life on January 6, 2022 in Beverly Hills, California. He not only had a tremendous impact on Hollywood and the culture at large, his immeasurable contributions to the civil rights movement and other humanitarian causes were equally poignant and inspirational.
Well, Sir Sidney Poitier is our final inductee this year, posthumously. And I'm going to get Al Brunson to please come forward, if he might, and just share a couple of things with us. Iconic individuals, for sure.
Good evening, everyone. I'm standing up here not because of my relationship with, you know, this museum in the way that the other inductees tonight, and I'm not an inductee, but the inductees tonight are honored for. I'm simply Jim Austin's best friend, and he's my best friend. When he and Gloria got together, they, you know, he let Gloria know, I come with the deal. So we were roommates in college. We've known each other for 50 years. We were college roommates at Howard University. He was in the School of Business. I was in the School of Architecture. Quite frankly, we actually were, I'm standing up here on behalf of Sir Sidney Poitier. We actually were classmates of his daughter, one of his daughters. And I knew her to look at her, to see her on campus, but Jim knew her. You know, that's the difference between Jim and I. I'm kind of low profile, high profile guy. He's always been. He has not changed at all. So I simply wanted to share with you, I know their passion, you know, for their museum. I don't have a problem saying, I don't share that, you know, but at the end of the day, it's my friend, and I support him. I have a great deal of knowledge about history in a number of areas, including that one. I love history. I learned the Dewey Decimal System early on in my life in elementary school. But I was trying to figure out how I was going to connect with Sir Sidney Poitier. So I had to enlarge that, and I would simply say my connection was through their experience in the military. Not just him, but Sammy Davis Jr. and Harry Belafonte. Three individuals that I, in a 32-year military career, I stand on their shoulders. They were in a segregated military. I had the fortune of serving in an integrated military. Didn't have you know, issues that they probably experienced, but at the end of the day, I'm able to connect. And I don't typically wear lapel pins on my suits, but in honor of that connection, I wear my 1st Infantry Division pin, which was the first unit that I served with. And I'm actually just returning from Normandy. I treated myself and my wife. We went to the beaches and saw the invasion beaches at Normandy a couple weeks ago. But again, Jim and Gloria, they are extremely passionate about this, and I am passionate about them and what they do. And I hope you can all share with me and just give them a round of applause. But about the closest thing to a horse is my granddaughter is actually competing today. She is an equestrian. So she has her and her horse, Lena, excuse me, her pony. She corrects me. I have a Palomino pony. It's not a horse. So they are competing today. She's a jumper. And I hope you can all, along with me, wish her the best in that aspect. The closest thing, again, I have come to in are providing mules to special forces in Afghanistan. So I thank you all and all the veterans. I thank you for your service, and thank you, Jim and Gloria.
Thank you, Al, very much, and thank you for being here. We very much appreciate your words. Before I close it up, I'm going to get a couple of people that you've heard about all night, but they're the reason that each and every one of us are here tonight. Talking about Jim and Gloria, let's put our hands together and welcome them to the microphone.
Thank you. Thank you, one and all. Thank you so very much for your acknowledgement. Thank you for your support. Thank you for your consideration of the efforts that we are making in trying to make sure that all aspects of American history are kept alive and well. Without you, it would be impossible to be as far-reaching as we're trying to be, because we hope that each of you will consider yourselves an ambassador of what we are doing and take the message out about actually what that Multicultural Western Heritage Museum in Fort Worth is really all about. Because even though we were founded in 2003, there are still far too many people who are not aware of the museum and the education that we are espousing. So that is the one thing I wish to ask of you tonight, is that if you would please be an ambassador and share the information about this museum, that it is something that is a good thing, is a positive thing, not only for young people, but for adults as well, for our community as well across the globe. So I thank you tonight for sharing your time with us. I thank you for sharing your resources with us, and I just urge you to please be a part of what we are doing continuously. And I especially want to thank our young people with our Boy Scout troop who have served so faithfully every year. We really appreciate you all so much. And I'd like to point out that this year we've added our QR code on the back of your program book, so you can just hit that and go directly to our website, and that will tell you a little bit more. And then if you would join us as a member, or at least sign up to receive our newsletter. And thank you to all of our team and everyone who played a part. And I'd like to ask all of our team, if you would please stand up. Miss Vivian, I see you right here. Miss Arlene, if you would stand up. Miss Rose, if you're in the room, who's here, who helped us to put this on together. You know, that staff that stays at the computers and do so much work and send out the press releases and all those mundane tasks. They are so important, and we couldn't do it without you. And I just want to say, sometimes you're overlooked, but I want you to know how much I appreciate you. And I'm taking this moment, and I'm taking this time to say thank you to those people who are the backbone of our organization. God bless you all. I wish you Godspeed. Congratulations to all of our inductees, to all of our alumni, and to your family and friends who have come out to show love and support for you tonight. And I want to thank my husband, Jim Austin, who has relentlessly shared about this museum with everyone that he could think of and those he didn't even know. He has heard an awful lot of no's over these 18 years, and I just want him to know how much I admire the tenacity that you have, because it definitely takes that to talk to people who are interested and also to people who are not interested. It takes a lot of courage to do that. And so I want to tell you that I admire you, and I thank God for you always. And I ask that he continue to crown you with wisdom and knowledge as you move forward in your life. Thank you all.
Thank you, Gloria, for those words. And as you know, we move through the halls and we celebrate the history of the forgotten cowboy. Because myself, I grew up, born in North Carolina, but mom said we're moving to New Jersey, where my dad had eight sisters. And I went kicking and screaming to New Jersey, but every summer they would allow me to go down to the farm. Uncle Bernard was a legend. And his baby boy was my best friend, who was two days older than me and taught me how to drive a tractor and taught me a lot of things. So I'm a country boy with some city swagger, okay? So down in the country, they thought I was smarter than them because I was from the city, but I was just as dumb as they were growing up. But a great life and all, and I thank my Uncle Bernard for being my mentor. Because we had to get up at 5 in the morning and go to work. You didn't just sit around Uncle Bernard's house and burn up his electricity and eat his food. But today has been great. We have to acknowledge the person that did all those videos and watching them as he did them one by one. His name is Evans Risher. And Mr. Risher right here. Yeah, that was his voice. That was his camera. He called each one of them, interviewed them, and he did it. And I want to thank him for doing that. He said, this year I'm getting a discount, though, okay? So I just want to say that. Where's his wife? Ms. Risher, he did commit to a discount, okay? So I also have to thank this young man over here that looks like me. Daniel, could you stand up? Yeah. Daniel's a bad boy within himself. I'm mentor to the Texas Wesleyan football team. And I met Daniel at a press conference at the team. And we shook hands, and I gave my card. So for the next week, he called me every day. He said, Mr. Austin, I want to come and intern for you. He said, I just got to do that. You're just my spirit. So finally, he checked with his teacher and a political science major. So he joined the team. And he said, Mr. Austin, you don't have to pay me. I said, come on, Daniel. You can come to work for me. So, you know, when you think of a son, you know, if I had to design or have a son, it would be just after this young man right here, Daniel Trio. And he calls me every day, Mr. Austin, you all right? I'm good, Daniel. So he's been with me for 3 weeks, 3 months, and he's moving to Austin. He is competing to be the punter for the Texas Longhorns. So he said, Mr. Austin, I'm going to win that position. So he's going to get his master's. He got his undergraduate degree at Texas Wesleyan, and he was kicking the ball. UT came and found him. So good luck, son, because he'll probably be playing in the pros sometime. Because when you think about football and you want to play football, that's the best thing to do is be the punter. So congratulations. Everybody, this was a great evening. I just ask you to consider making a donation to the museum to become a member. Yes, sir. And the silent auction is still open, Chuck. Yeah, so we'll keep it open for 5 more minutes afterwards and get some. And those who bought the Cowboy tickets, yes, you'll be sitting with Jim Austin at the game, young lady, okay? And they're good seats. You can see the whole game and the screen from those seats. And who bought the cabin, thank you, my brother, for doing that. We appreciate that. That my financial advisor, Vince Nelson, donated that, and it's a beautiful cabin. You will enjoy that. Okay, for sure. I want to tell my wife, Gloria, honey, I love you. And, you know, you just make the world a better place for me and always being there standing beside me. And, you know, a lot of friends that I see, they when they greet me, they walk up and they say, where's Gloria? I said, that is not my name. My name is Jim. You know, it's just blatant. I mean, all straight to it. So thank you for being a great executive director and working hard, putting all this together. And I guarantee you will not find one misspelled word in that program directory, okay? She was very anal about that and went over and over it, so all that. Vivian, thank you, my public relations lady. Been in Thailand for a year or 2 years. So she said, Jim keeps sending the check and she keeps working from Thailand and all. So thank you, Vivian. Scott, you know, you my dude, you know, you're my guy. And Scott does about 600 of these. And you said, there's 365 days in a year. He is the man. When there's a program, he's there. But every time we called last year, he had a family event. He said, I'm going to be with you. Today, someone got honored at SMU. He said, Jim, I got to go by there and show my face. So let's give Scott a round of applause. And I told Scott, because he's been with us so long, we were going to name the banquet the Scott Murray Hall of Fame Banquet. He said, really? I said, no, I'm kidding. And Jane, thank you for always coming here and being with us too. And I told Scott, you're the important one in this place. So you stand by him, you guys are just enjoying life. And he's probably raised hundreds of millions of dollars for nonprofits throughout the country and all. He's always the same, for sure. Steve Murren, thank you, the mayor of the Stockyards. I know, they know the auctions over there. Okay, yeah, help Steve out. Because when we moved into the Stockyards, there wasn't a lot of people that were happy about that, just being a minority museum. But Steve Murren, Hub Baker, Pam Minnick, they just say it's good for the museum to be in the Stockyard. Because money is, you know, money doesn't see color. So we bring awareness into the Stockyards that people of color start coming up there. There's 5 million people that come through the Stockyards to see the herd and experience. So we're just trying to get our little 1% coming through the museum. And this was a great evening. And I'm going to get off the stage before Vivian starts winking at me and my wife starts kicking me in the back. But let's have the Hall of Famers that are here stand up. Let's give them a round of applause. Yeah. Thank you, my friends. And if you know someone that is worthy, that should be inducted into our Hall of Fame, just download the application and submit it. And if you think you should be admitted yourself, go ahead and send your own application in, okay? So, but thanks so much. Have a great evening. Scott is going to close it out.
Have you all had a good time tonight?
Yeah.
I tell you what, as I stood up here tonight, and Jim just had all the inductees. We need all of you to come on the stage as soon as we wrap things up here in about a minute, because we want to get a group picture of everybody. So, but that said and done, as I sat and listened to everybody, every single person that came up here that was an inductee tonight, and the message they shared, and as Jim and Gloria both know, they've asked me to serve as MC at this event for a long time. And every year, there's some great things that were said. But everybody tonight talked about family and friends and just being committed to coming together and making it happen in a positive, productive way. You know, you hear so much about diversity and inclusion and just what goes on in our world today. And you get up in the morning, what's going to happen? You see schools and shootings and this and that. Oh my gosh, it just goes on and on. And I, when I'm around the country, when I'm not emceeing something, I created a speech a couple of years ago, actually before the pandemic, just before the pandemic, and boy, it certainly makes sense now. It's called Creating Champions of Change Through a Culture of Civility. People are not kind, courteous, and respectful to anybody anymore. I mean, road rage, that was something that I never even heard of when I was 20 years old. People didn't get like they do just driving down the road. Our whole world has just changed. And I've written a couple of books in the process of writing a third, and I also love to write poetry. I love to write things that rhyme. So I wrote a creed that I think sums up best who we are and what we're all about. It's my Leadership America creed, Leaders for Life, Creating Champions of Change Through a Culture of Civility. So I thought I'd close tonight. As a result of what I've heard everybody say here tonight, I think this hopefully is something that you can take home and share with your friends and family about how we all need to come together in a positive, productive way. goes something like this. It says, living life is not about me. A purposeful life is all about we. Sharing together all that we see, even though we might not always agree. Respectful and kind is forever key. Truthful and transparent is really what we should be. Eradicating the anger and the hateful debris. Live not in a world where we need referees. Let us move forward in a place we foresee, diverse and inclusive for both he and she. Matters not religion nor race. Faith is for thee. We must live in a world that's our home of the free. And that's what we need to be a part of. And the ones that'll make that happen are all the people that we inducted tonight and all the friends and family that joined them to salute them all. So as we leave here tonight, remember what these two people behind me put together almost two decades ago, so we all can live collectively as one, almost as a family, that we're proud citizens of the United States of America, the greatest country on the face of this earth. But right now, it's got a heck of a lot of issues, and we need to come together and make them be in the right direction, our home of the free. Stay safe. Thanks, everybody. Good night. Need all our inductees back up on the stage right away. All the inductees.